23rd of November, 1658, a solemn procession wended its way through the silent streets of London towards Westminster Abbey. It was the funeral procession of the most powerful ruler the British Isles had known since the fall of Rome. This latter-day emperor had achieved what had eluded the greatest warrior kings of the Middle Ages, welding the countries of England, Scotland, and Ireland into one united kingdom. He had bent Parliament to his will, levied taxes as he pleased, stilled the fratricidal religious conflict of the Reformation, and created the most feared navy and army in Europe. He lay in his robe of state, a scepter in one hand, an orb in the other, with an imperial crown laid on a velvet cushion a little above his head. Yet this ruler was not a king. He was instead a regicide, a king killer. His name was Oliver Cromwell. England, 1644. For 2 years, the country had been embroiled in a bloody civil war between King Charles I and Parliament. The issues in dispute were taxation, the army, and the church. Charles had yielded tax raising to Parliament, but he wouldn't surrender his powers as commander-in-chief, still less his God-given right as supreme governor of the Church of England to appoint its bishops and regulate its worship according to his own ceremonious beliefs. Because of the importance Charles and his followers attached to bishops, they became known as Episcopalians, from the Latin for bishops. Charles's opponents felt equally strongly against bishops and ceremonies, which meant there was nothing for it but to fight. But after a dozen battles and thousands dead, the war had bogged down. For the parliamentarians, the stalemate provoked crisis and soul-searching. Matters came to a head in 1644 when two leading parliamentary generals, Edward Montagu, Earl of Manchester, and his up-and-coming deputy, Oliver Cromwell, each sought to have the other dismissed. For they differed irreconcilably about tactics, war aims, and above all, about religion. Were they fighting the king to crush him, or merely to bring him to the negotiating table? The latter was Manchester's view. Aristocrat that he was, he couldn't conceive of a kingless world. He also had a thoroughly realistic fear of Charles's residual authority. If we fight the king 100 times and beat him 99, he will be king still, he said. But if he beat us once or the last time, we shall be hanged, we shall lose our estates, and our posterities will be undone. Manchester reflected the views of the majority religious faction in Parliament, the Presbyterians. They wanted a church stripped of Charles's ceremonies, which they hated as popish, and ruled not by bishops under the king, but by assemblies of clergy, known as presbyteries. But there was another, even more radical position. These men, and women too, since religion was one of the few areas of public policy where women were free to express themselves, rejected all human authority in religion and all fixed outward forms of worship. Instead, they believed in their Christian liberty in association only with other like-minded individuals, to seek after truth and to follow the Holy Spirit wherever it led them, personally and individually. Hence the various names by which they were known: independents, separatists, seekers. And one such seeker was Oliver Cromwell himself. Cromwell, Manchester's opponent in the clash of 1644, had been born in 1599. Protestantism was in his blood, and it was further drummed into him, indeed beaten into him, at school and university. Like many religious men, Cromwell experienced a crisis of faith in his 30s, from which he emerged with a burning confidence in his own salvation. He was a big, bony, practical, rather awkward man. Hands-on, sporty, unscholarly, despite his Cambridge days, but with the gift of the gab and a knack for popular leadership. Fearless, no respecter of persons, however grand, or institutions, however venerable, Cromwell was a man waiting for God to reveal himself to him in action. And what God revealed in Cromwell's own astonishing transformation from country squire to brilliant general was that Charles must be defeated and forced to accept Parliament's terms. Instead, Cromwell insinuated, Manchester's belief in a negotiated settlement had led him to pull his punches on the battlefield. But Cromwell went further. Not only must parliamentary generals be imbued with a new will to victory, there must also be a fundamental reform of the existing parliamentary forces. Cromwell's arguments carried the day, and the result was the creation in February 1645 of the New Model Army. This was England's first truly professional fighting force, properly paid and equipped by Parliament and organised on the revolutionary principle that its officers be chosen by merit rather than social rank. The first great test of the New Model Army came here at Naseby on the 14th of June, 1645. On the Royalist side was the flower of English chivalry, led by King Charles himself in gilt armour and mounted on his beautiful Flemish horse. In contrast, the parliamentarians were a drab and uniform company. In Cromwell's own words of poor, prayerful men, the solid ranks of Cromwell's new model cavalry proved decisive. By 1 o'clock in the afternoon, Charles had lost his infantry, his artillery, and, in effect, the kingdom. God would, Cromwell wrote after the battle, by things which are not, bring to nothing things that are. It was a biblically inspired messianic confidence which Cromwell shared with his troops. The New Model Army proved to be the decisive weapon in Parliament's struggle with the King. But in forging this weapon, Parliament had called into being a new power in the land, and one whose strength would grow with each victory that it won. After the battle, the army was visited by a clergyman, Richard Baxter. Baxter was a noted Presbyterian who had preached against the king's religious policies. Nevertheless, like most Englishmen, he anticipated that the king would eventually agree to a negotiated settlement.